You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you have pen and paper by your side tonight, because I'm going to be imparting to you some knowledge that is very difficult to come by. It's going to help you understand who is bringing about the changes that are destroying this country. Whose agenda is it that is providing the nexus for the downfall of this great nation? Who are these people? What do they believe? Tonight's subject is secret societies and psychological warfare. Don't go away. I'll be right back.
Thank you. turn on the light. You can reach a fence by the moon. And you won't make me jealous if I hear the big pieces in your head. Now we were lovers like that.
A description of Anthony Schaefer's protagonist in the film The Wicker Man, and I quote, "Tearing around in dizzying circles trying to solve it, never able to guess the true plot beyond it, although the evidence of it lies all around him," end quote. Cinefantastic. Charles Hoy Fort said this, "Almost all people of all eras are hypnotics. Their beliefs are induced beliefs. The proper authorities saw to it that the proper belief should be induced, and people believed properly." J.H. Towson in Clowns said this, quote, "As the mountebank delivered his harangue, the clown would repeatedly poke his head out from behind the curtain, making fun of everything his master said, parodying his patter and twisting the meaning of his words. The mountebank played the perfect straight man, meanwhile. Here he was, trying so hard to hawk his wares, and his assistant was doing everything possible to undermine sales. The merriment was, of course, intentional. While the clown seemingly encouraged the public not to buy the proffered merchandise, the mountebank knew full well that the bystanders would easily be converted into customers as soon as they forgot that they were, in fact, supposed to be buying. Once the audience had been effectively hypnotized, once its judgment and willpower had been weakened, the real sales pitch could begin," end quote. And in the Encyclopedia of Freemasonry, Dr. Albert Mackey, 33rd degree, defines hoodwink as, quote, "a symbol of the secrecy, silence, and darkness in which the mysteries of our art should be preserved from the unhallowed gaze of the profane," end quote. In a study, ladies and gentlemen, of mind control and psychological warfare, it is not enough to simply review the latest technology of coercion, the most recent gadgetry and techno-junk littering the hardware and supply depots of governments and so-called cults. You see, far more dangerous than these appliances is the praxis behind them, ages old, the underground current which informs the modern project and this modern era. You see, for life in our modern era is little more than life in an open-air mind-control laboratory where a form of human alchemy has emerged to transform the mass of targeted percipients, the lead, targeted merely by virtue of their being urban dwellers plugged into the electronic and digital pageantry of the establishment's system of things. Into the perfect human zombie, gold. To those who practice this ancient science that is never meant what any of you ever thought. I've heard so many people ridicule alchemy as being absolutely impossible to transform base elements. But you see, that's not what it was ever about. Not ever. In those days, when the church and kings ruled with an iron hand, and anyone who did anything that was not politically correct or religiously correct were swiftly and most terribly punished. So they disguised their true intent and their true teachings, the esoteric, with a system of exoteric descriptions. But to the profane would mean one thing, and to the initiate or the adept would mean quite another. But that was then. This is now. What sort of creature inhabits the modern domain? Who is the modern man? Well, the puppet masters say he is the smartest, most advanced individual to ever strut the planet, the most relatively liberated being in history. But Louis Ferdinand Céline said it well, quote, "What does the modern public want? It wants to go down on its knees before money and before crap," end quote. You see, the public have been trained to do this by two principal methods: direct speaking, archetypal messages of pure terror, psychic driving, as the CIA's Dr. Ewan Cameron termed it, encoded in massively publicized lone nut mass murders, and the sinister flattery heaped upon them by their masters in the cult of civilization and progress. The acid test of a human being's freedom and will to protect the quality of his life lies in a person's attitude toward his oppressor. What is modern man's attitude toward Wall Street and the bankers and the elite? That body of adepts known as the secret college, that combined are known as the Illuminati or the Order. What is modern man's attitude toward Dan Rather and the ignorance bestowing media and advertising man, toward Lincoln and Truman, Franklin Delano Roosevelt and Reagan, George Bush, Johnny Carson, Exxon, and Monsanto, and William Clinton? Well, as one writer has observed, and I quote, "The most amazing thing about the American people is that they are constantly defending their worst betrayers," end quote. So I ask you again, who then is the modern man? Well, if you've listened to this broadcast long enough, you know my interpretation. He is a mind-bombed patsy, an ignorant, apathetic twit who gets his marching orders from twilight language, keywords sprinkled throughout his news and current events. And even as he dances to the tune of the elite managers of human behavior, provoked by buzzwords, he scoffs with great derision at the idea of the existence and operation of a technology of mass mind control emanating from the media and government. And that is most unfortunate. modern man believes that he is much too smart to believe anything as superstitious as that. But the truth is, modern man, ladies and gentlemen, is the ideal hypnotic subject, puffed up on the idea that he is the crown of creation. He vehemently denies the power of the hypnotist's control over him, even as his head bobs up and down on the string. Anyone who believes what anyone else writes or says without thoroughly researching it and making sure that it is absolutely true is a puppet on a string. And when the puppet master calls the tune, he will dance. What we observe in the population today are the three destructive symptoms of persons whose minds are controlled by alien forces, and I do not mean from Mars. These forces are amnesia, in effect loss of memory. The second is abulia, or loss of will. The third is apathy, loss of interest in events vital to one's own health and survival. Amnesia, abulia, and apathy are nearly universal among us today, and gaining a greater foothold with every passing day. A Japanese philosopher, George Osawa, stated that there was only one incurable sickness, arrogance. If a patient does not regard himself as sick, he cannot submit to a cure. That's why I've urged you, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to see what is wrong with America today, go into your bathroom and look into the mirror. You will find the problem staring at you. And at that point, when you make that realization, you must admit to yourself, I have been stupid, I am stupid, I am ignorant, I am apathetic, and I must change. And if you do not, nothing will change, nothing will become better. Nothing at all. The arrogant man does not need to see. He already sees almost everything. And what he thinks he has yet to learn, he believes the experts will one day show him. And who are these experts? They are not really doctors of the soul, ladies and gentlemen. They do not have the man's interest at heart. They are, in fact, his worst enemies. His most cunning manipulators, who lead him to do their bidding like any slave master since Egypt. Why then does modern man revere them? Well, it's very simply because, ladies and gentlemen, they flatter him. And that's why you don't get any flattery from me, ever. You never have. I call the shots as they are. I tell you the truth, no matter who it hurts or helps, even if it hurts me. And oh, how you hate it. Oh, how you hate to hear the truth. The man who tells the truth is universally disliked by every person. Because every person has an agenda and is hiding behind a fantasy which the truth penetrates like an arrow and leaves him stripped naked before the whole universe. And he does not like that. But yet it must be. For a great man once said, my leader once said, seek ye the truth, and the truth will make you free. Nothing else will. And without the truth, no man or woman is free, can be free, or ever will be free. But the truth hurts. The truth strips all away and stands golden before all men. Yet how many of you trade that gold of the truth for the lead of the fantasy and the lies? How many of you are going backward in the alchemical process? Modern man reveres his puppet masters, his overseers, because they flatter him. This is the very first secret of mass mind control and can be observed as the foundation stone of virtually every single false religion, party, cult, philosophy, system, training, and great organized church. How can modern man free himself when he is told that he is already a demigod? That the problem lies only in finding a pure enough economic or political system worthy of his high-minded brilliance. Oh. If we look closely, we will see, ladies and gentlemen, that this mind control principle is so basic and simple, it is almost stupidly so, to the point that we marvel that anyone would or could be seduced by it. But it's only a matter of attention, as we saw in the parable of the mountebank and the clown. You see, arrogant hypnopathies have been told by their masters that they are demigods, and demigods are never deceived or distracted. They're too smart. And by their arrogant self-satisfaction, they blind themselves to the simplicity of the device that ensnares them, and that is when the real sales pitch begins. You see, what the alchemical managers have bred over a millennia is a human race of the most wretched stupidity and ignorance unrivaled in thousands of years. These blind slaves are told they are free and highly educated, and they believe it, even as they march behind signs that would cause any medieval peasant to run screaming away from them in panic-stricken terror. The symbols that modern man embraces with the naive trust of an infant would be tantamount to billboards reading, quote, "This way to your death and enslavement," end quote, to the understanding of a traditional peasant of antiquity. It was their world. They understood it perfectly. I doubt seriously any medieval man would have much difficulty in feeling a sense of overwhelming foreboding in the face of the Soviet hammer and sickle symbol. Yet most modern literate people obviously don't know a thing about what that symbol actually represents, except on the most profane level as the implements of the farmer and the worker. You really believe that? The sickle, ladies and gentlemen, symbolizes Saturn, also known as Kronos Saturn, or as the Greeks called it, Demiurgos, the operating engineer of the universe, as opposed to the creator of that universe, Satan, Lucifer. In the reign of Saturn, we see exorbitant building and modeling activities, and this is reflected in the Masonic reference to their god as the big builder or architect, and their nickname, the builders. Who erected the Tower of Babel? All this sounds reasonably attractive. Many of us can appreciate magnificent buildings and splendid projects along those lines. But as usual, ladies and gentlemen, there's much more to it than this. You see, that's the exoteric interpretation. Underneath is the truth. How many of you drive Saturns? How many of you drive Mazdas? How many of you even know the origin of those names and what they stand for? This Saturnian Masonic edifice complex. Not Oedipus, but edifice complex. Ultimately is building against the grain, against nature. What's wrong with that? Well, you'll stick with me and you'll see. At the beginning, in the early eras, nature's forces were manipulated with a knowledge which required the greatest intimacy with her ways, as reflected in the various megalithic structures in the British Isles, Europe, and even ancient America. There's even beauty, simplicity, and power in this early architecture. And modern enthusiasts have mistaken the knowledge and sensitivity to natural forces intrinsic to this ancient technology as indicative of a positive force at work. But actually, with some crucial exceptions, the rise of the megaliths marked the rise of the Hermetic Academy into its dominant physical phase. The theory is that the megaliths pinned down natural forces, helping to subdue nature's most savage furies. We marvel today at the Hoover Dam, but that symbol laden construction is but a crude parody of the technology of the megaliths which helped to dam the wildest forces of nature. The construction of these megaliths, heralded by New Age types as marvels of ancient ingenuity and cooperation with nature, are actually the first physical evidence of the end of Eden, of that period on earth when humanity lived as the servants and friends of God's natural creation, as nomads and hunter-gatherers. You see, the great error of modern enthusiasts for what they regard as the magical, Merlin-esque, harmonious time of the Druids and Stonehenge in ancient Egypt is ignorance of the fact that the historical period they idolize was itself immersed in a tampering technology and materialism, which essentially marked a revolutionary break. A break. The cutting off. The severing of man's relation with the natural order. Well, what is wrong with that, you say? Well, according to John Mitchell, he said, the first revolution of Olympus marks the first deviation from the primeval ways of men presided over by Cronus, otherwise Saturn. End quote. Saturn is Lucifer, Satan. And this revolution marks the end of man's Edenic relationship with the natural world. You never understood it before, did you? I hope you're beginning to now. Henceforward, man is alienated from nature by means of the Saturnian Sith, which symbolizes the sense of separation from God's natural creation that man experienced after the fall. You see how simple it all really is? And it really is that simple, ladies and gentlemen. Don't go away. I'll be right back.
I've been so shattered, it will reach you everywhere. And I sing this for the captain. The ship has not been big. For the mother in confusion, her cradle still unfit. For the heart with no companion, for the soul without a king, for the prima ballerina who cannot dance to anything.
Good days
the change that I've come through the night of wild distress.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Hour of the Time is brought to you by Swiss America Trading. They specialize in non-reportable, non-confiscatable hard assets. Now, let me just clarify what that means. It means that right now, you don't have to, according to the law, report these transactions of a certain nature concerning gold and silver coins. And the government or anyone else can confiscate those gold or silver coins according to current law. But don't be misled. They could change that law tomorrow and require that it all be reported retroactively, and they could show up on your doorstep the following day to confiscate every penny. So you must take steps to safeguard yourself and your assets as any responsible person would. All throughout the history of the world, there has only been one major money recognized by all peoples. What is money? Money is not what you think it is, most of you anyway. It is not the paper, phony, lying Federal Reserve notes that are in your pockets. For the Federal Reserve is not federal, there is no reserve, and they are not notes. And when you read on them that they represent $1 or $2 or $5 or $20, that also is a lie. For dollar is a unit of measurement and purity of silver coin in the law. So that piece of paper that you have in your pocket can no more be a dollar than a quart can be milk. I hope you understand that. According to the Constitution, no state shall tender in payment of debt anything other than gold or silver coin. What is going on? What is happening? The law defines a dollar as a specific weight and measurement of purity of silver coin or an equal value of gold coin. What is going on here? The Constitution has never been changed. The law has not been changed. Why are you trading with plastic and paper? Throughout the history of the world, no paper system has ever succeeded. They have all gone down in flaming inflation to the ruin of the people and the country in which these systems existed. Throughout the history of the world, no gold or silver economy has ever failed. Never in the history of the world. Amazing, isn't it? Why didn't someone teach you this when you were in school? In fact, why didn't they even teach you how to balance a checkbook? Why didn't they teach you anything about money? Very simply, ladies and gentlemen, it's so that they can manipulate you and steal you blind. Call Swiss America Trading. Ask for the new newsletter just out, written by Craig Smith. It's just come out. You've got to have it. It will open your eyes. 1-800-289-2646. Call now. You'll be glad that you did. Look around at all of those sitting around you, the people that you love or claim to love. If you can't look them directly in the eye at this very moment and tell them that you have secured at least a portion of your assets in real money, the only thing that has never, ever changed its value in all of the history of the world, for you can still buy exactly the same number of loaves of bread with 1 ounce of gold today as you could 1,000 years ago, as you could 1,000 years ago. If you can't look them in the eye and assure them that you have perfected at least a portion of your assets in real money, you must make this call, or you very simply don't love them. 1-800-289-2646. Tell them that you're a steady listener to the Hour of the Time, and you'll get red carpet treatment. I guarantee it. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. A great weight will be lifted from your shoulders.
We must be paid for the cash. We shit has not been good. For a mother in confusion, the cradle crumpled. For the heart with no companion, for the soul without a peace, for the dream of
ladies and gentlemen, man began his peregrination away from Eden through his conceit that he would become as God. Remember what happened in the Garden of Eden? God told Adam and Eve to tend the garden. Don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He commanded them not to. And he told them what would happen if they did. If ye do, ye will surely die. Lucifer, through his agent Satan, seduced Eve and told her, God lied to you. He's hiding your true nature. He doesn't want you to know that if you eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you too will become as gods. And Eve, in turn, seduced Adam. That's the story in the book of Genesis. Now, I'm not telling any of you to believe any of this. I am teaching you the esoteric knowledge of the mysteries. And in these mystery schools and mystery religions, they believe that Lucifer was the good one and God, Jehovah, was the bad one. Because he was holding man enslaved in the chains, the bonds of ignorance in this Garden of Eden. Lucifer, through his agent Satan, set man free, knocked off the chains with the gift of knowledge. And through the use of this gift of knowledge, man himself will become God. That is the story. And so many people fall for this deception. For no man, I can assure you, will ever be God. Ever. No part can ever be equal to or greater than the whole. That's one of the greatest lessons you can ever learn. You think you could pick up a bushel of apples, squeeze them together, and make the original tree from which they came? No. You can take the seed from the apple and plant it and grow another apple tree, but that apple tree will not be the original tree from which the seed sprang. Never. Not ever in a million years. Nor can all of the apple trees from all of the seeds from all of the apples that fell from that tree ever in their entirety be that same original tree. Now, of course, I'm making a little metaphor here, which is nothing even approaching the discrepancy between man becoming a god and God who made man. And I hope you can understand that. Man has a conceit that he would become as God. Yet, as soon as he left the divine plan for the occult process, his stated objective became the Kabbalistic tikkun olam, or, quote, repair of the world, end quote. In other words, God's creation was not perfect. Man is going to perfect it. Man is going to repair the imperfections in God's world via the intervention and imposition of human brain power, the very egomaniacal device that caused the separation from God's natural Eden in the very first place. Repair of the world. Indeed!
a world the Kabbalists had only just ruined. Repair the world? Man can't even repair himself. I don't know any man that's perfect. I don't know any man that hasn't had problems. I don't know any man that's not hiding some dastardly secret he doesn't want anybody else to know. I don't know any man who hasn't done wrong to himself or others. Repair the world? Repair yourself first. And I doubt it can be done. It is not the nature of man. After the Saturnian division, Hermetic man saw himself as separate and inevitably above nature, though always quick to identify himself as nature's benign shepherd. Oh, what a deception this is. This mighty occult shepherd king figure has emerged in history under the forms of Arthur, Merlin, Pendragon, Prester John. John F. Kennedy, and many others. He is the personification of the manipulation of nature by secret technology on behalf of a secret hierarchy, which, if known at all, is always careful to present itself as the supreme friend of divine creation. If the expulsion from the Garden of Eden, that is to say, the literal alteration of man's circumstance of living solely upon God's bounty and providence, was the result of satanic intervention, why has it not dawned on us that civilization is itself satanic? Oh, that's a good one to send you to bed with, isn't it? But that's exactly the question that you should be pondering. In the Hermetic Masonic tradition, the secret identity of Satan is the force represented in occult lore as emanating from the star Sirius, the so-called dog star, Canis Major. And in the secret tradition of the Freemasons, Sirius is overwhelmingly identified with a single primary attribute, the bringing of civilization to Earth. The heirs of this magical current were saluted by the illuminist and master alchemist Comenius in his 1668 book entitled The Way of Light. Remember, Lucifer is the fallen angel of light. The book was dedicated to the first scientific organization in Western history, Britain's August Royal Society. In it, Comenius addressed the first formal scientists as, quote, Illuminati, end quote, and outlined their scientific purpose, quote, which is to secure the empire of the human mind over matter, end quote. And I've had so many people call me or write me and deny the very existence of the Illuminati. In a key Rosicrucian description of the city of Utopia, it is shown to be dominated, ladies and gentlemen, by science and mechanics, and more ominously, by the medical dissection of cadavers, in other words, by the hyper-analytical obsession of rationalism with dead matter and measurement. The Utopian city of the Rosicrucians is before us today. New York and Los Angeles, Babylon the Great. And it was planned in 1668 and long, long before. You see, we have forgotten the depth of the roots of the modern disease. We have accepted the pop-pap that anything that predated the more obvious rapacity of modern industrial pollution was natural or magical. The notion of magic being identified with the pristine. Hence, we have denied ourselves knowledge of the beginning of the rise of the cryptocracy. John Mitchell said, quote, It is their immediate concern, having eaten of the tree of knowledge, to apply all their newly acquired arts to constructing a facsimile of the garden, a model paradise, end quote. But you see, they just don't get it. There was already an architecture prior to man's imposition of his structures and inventions. This was the architecture of the natural landscape as shaped by God. To claim that to have left it as it was would have been barbarous and backward is symptomatic of the diseased occult mind and its gigantic egotistical pathology. I have never in my life seen anything ever built or rendered by the hand of man that ever equaled the absolute breathtaking beauty of the natural scape. As long as it was left as God created, it was paradise. Everybody is looking for the Garden of Eden. Don't you understand? It's all around you. The earth is the Garden of Eden. We were cast out of it. Due to our blindness, we feverishly cooperate with the imposition upon the earth as our own version of Eden, which always ends in the creation of Babylon, hell on earth. John Mitchell said again, quote, "Settlement leads to the establishment of social hierarchies, to specialization, the development of arts and sciences, the building of temples and houses. For millions of years, men, essentially the same as we are now, lived without these and presumably without feeling the need for them." Tacitus described a German tribe that lived entirely without artificial shelter. The phenomenon of successive towns built around the same sacred place, the spirit of which became the foundation deity, receiving the sacrifices offered in expiation of the crime of settlement and giving the law by which the city was governed. Implicit in this law was a contract between man and God by which the first was permitted a conditional and limited use of land for agricultural and building in return for duties and observances paid to the second. So it was understood by the founding fathers of all of the ancient cities. And the rituals tell you this. But as cities expand, these limitations become more onerous and neglected, with the result that, in the language of Apocalypse, the city becomes Babylon, the parasitic whore, and proceeds toward destruction. And this belief, the traditional element in ancient Rome, objected to expansion beyond the original city boundaries, considering it a breach of the foundation contract. Such counsels were, of course, ignored, just as they're ignored today, and in consequence, Rome, following the career of all previous empires, became Babylon indeed. Civilization, you see, tends to grow more elaborate and to make ever greater demands on the earth that sustains it. There comes a time when the old natural devotion to the earth is exchanged for the desire to increase the products of the earth by artificially stimulating its fertility. This stage is marked in history by the appearance of sun gods, divinities of reason, intellect, and centralized government, whose legends refer always to their victories over dragons, in effect, nature. The dragon is sometimes representative of self. The battle in the mind. When St. George was said to have slain the dragon, he overcame himself. This policy of artificially increasing the earth's fertility and multiplying the gifts of its spirit instead of accepting what is given by nature is evident in the staking of the earth in symbolism, as is seen in the motif of the knight spearing the dragon, which is sometimes viewed as the pinnacle of the victory of light over dark. How many times have you heard Clinton say that? There's a great battle between the forces of light over the forces of darkness. Cicero said the same thing. Hitler said the same thing. All through history, despots and Babylons have been mouthing the same thing over and over and over again. But ladies and gentlemen, we should also be aware that there is an alternate, occult reading of this image. This Arthurian symbol has been celebrated by pagans and Freemasons as a sign of man's usurpation of natural creation. The staking process is seen by them as a means to pin down the heretofore flowing character of the energy of creation so as to be harnessed and bled by Stonehenge-like technology in order to give greater and greater resources to man. The Washington Monument is one such pinning down. It is the phallus of Osiris, the generative force, capturing the creative energy for man's use. Mitchell said, quote, the appearance of the sun god signals the introduction of a technology that aims to alter the natural channels of the earth spirit and to stimulate its energies for the benefit of an increasingly large settled population. From all that has recently been discovered about the scientific knowledge and methods of the megalith builders, it appears that their system was in the magical tradition of Egypt, Babylon, and the ancient East. At Delphi, by spearing the serpent and localizing its energies, Apollo raised the productivity of the oracle. Every ancient standing stone is like the omphalos in the temple of Apollo, driven into the head of the telluric serpent, current fixing and augmenting the earth energies which had formerly fluctuated. Yet in the end, the system became onerous and ineffective, demanding at least as much from the people as it gave in return. Here is revealed the inevitable betrayal by the institutionalized system of technology of the people who have come to depend upon it. The land had become more productive, the people richer and more numerous, until, under the influence of cyclical changes in the heavens, the flow began to withdraw from the temples and take other paths. The latter-day priests, having neglected the principles of the old astronomical science by which the temples were first sited and planned, and no longer sensitive to the earth's spiritual energies, could only resort to more frantic invocations, attended by ever-increasing sacrifice in attempts to repeat the former results, and thus followed, as it has on many occasions and in many places over the world, a reaction against the artificial and ever more futile proceedings of the magicians and a return to simpler ways, end quote. We will continue this tomorrow night. Good night, ladies and gentlemen, and God bless each and every single one of you.
Voice he sees. I will speak no more. I shall abide until I am spoken for. Let it be your will.
This is the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network.